Well, hello there, and welcome to our fifth video in this topic on nutrition in humans. Now, I wonder if you've been digesting this topic so far. And if you can remember, what are the end products of digestion, right, for carbohydrates, proteins, and fats? Do you remember? Right, I hope you remember glucose, amino acids, and fatty acids, and glycerol. We'll be talking about that in this video. And I hope you also remember what is the stage that happens after digestion. And I hope that you remember that it is absorption. And so I hope that in this video, you'll be able to absorb a lot of information and learn the topic well. So let's move on. So we know that absorption happens in the small intestine. And in this video, we'll be talking about how absorption happens, as well as the structure of the small intestine and this thing called a villus, which you'll see later, play a role in absorption. Alright, so these are the textbook pages. Have a read through them as well. Now, actually, we can summarize absorption in these two statements. Firstly, the end products of digestion, which we talked about just now, glucose, amino acids, fatty acids, and glycerol, are absorbed in the small intestine, and especially the ileum, which is the last part of the small intestine. While water and mineral salts are absorbed in both the small intestine and the colon, right, which is the large intestine. So now let's look a bit deeper at the small intestine. Now, we'd like you to observe this very gross piece of small intestine here, which has been cut open for your viewing, and I want you to look at the inner surface of the small intestine. What do you notice about it? Well, you might notice that the inner surface of the small intestine has many folds. Here you can see up and down, many folds. It's not smooth. And we call these circular folds. Now let's zoom in on one of these folds, shall we? Zoom in. Woohoo! And if you look closely at one of these folds, this is a fold here. This is one fold. Two, four. If you look at the folds closely, what do you see on them? Well, you might see these little finger-like projections, these little finger-like structures, and we call these finger-like projections villi. So each fold bears many finger-like projections called villi. Now that's the plural. Okay, the singular is villus, so many villi and one villus. Now let's zoom in on a villus here. Zoom in. Now this here is a villus. Okay, so many villi, and this is a villus. Now we're going to be looking closely, more closely at the structure of this villus. Now I must tell you that the very first time I showed the picture of a villus to my class, they instantly burst out laughing. I'm really not sure why boys and girls get very excited about this sort of shape, but this is a villus and it is found in your small intestine. So think straight. Now, what is the structure of the villus, right? Let's take a closer look. Now, you see this outer layer here, this outer layer of cells. Okay, we call this the epithelium. This is the epithelium, right? And it's made up of many cells. It is made up of many intestinal, epithelial cells. Alright, so the epithelium is made up of many intestinal epithelial cells. Now here on the inside, labeling here, this structure here and this structure here, so like here, this structure, these are the blood capillaries. Right, so inside the villus, there are blood capillaries. There's a network of blood capillaries. Now there's also this inner structure here in the middle, and that's called the lacteal or the lymphatic capillaries. Okay, we'll see that these two capillaries play a different function. Now you might notice about this arrow here is to show you that this is the nutrient-rich blood leaving the villus. Right, so blood goes in this way, can you see? Blood goes in through these capillaries here, Okay, they go through the villus, moving through the villus, they absorb nutrients, and then the nutrient-rich blood will leave the villus in this way. So that's the flow of blood through the villus. Alright, now we're going to zoom in and take a closer look here. So I'm going to zoom in here on the next slide. You will see a row of epithelial cells, the epithelium. You will see the inside where there are blood vessels and lacteals. And you'll see the outside where our products of digestion will be, like glucose and amino acids. Okay, that's the outside. Now, the outside part here is also called the small intestine lumen. Okay, it is basically the tube, right? The space of the small intestine. So if this is my small intestine, I draw a tube, right? And inside is very folded, remember? Okay. And then here on the folds, there's many villi. Alright, so this space here, this is called the lumen of the small intestine. Okay, it's the hole. It's like where all your digested nutrients flow through. And you can see that the outside of the villus, so this part here outside the villus, is the lumen of the small intestine. Alright, so get yourself straight with that first. Alright, so this is the zoom-in part, right? I told you you'll see a row of epithelial cells. This is the epithelium. On the inside of the villus, we have the blood capillaries and the lacteals. On the outside of the villus, or we call the small intestine lumen. In the small intestine lumen, we have all the end products of digestion. So the question is, how are these end products absorbed from the small intestine lumen outside the villus to inside the villus? How are they absorbed? Now let's look at glucose and amino acids first. Now, glucose and amino acids are absorbed by diffusion, right? That means the concentration in the small intestine lumen is higher than in the blood capillaries. So they get absorbed by diffusion into the blood capillaries, alright? So into the blood capillaries. Now what happens though is that as you absorb more and more glucose into your blood capillaries, the blood capillaries start to have a very high concentration of glucose. So what happens when the concentration of glucose and amino acids is very high in capillaries? Can you still absorb by diffusion? No. So we need to use something else. And we've learned about this. We need to use active transport. Right, so when the concentration of the end products is very high in the blood capillaries compared to the lumen, we can absorb glucose and amino acids by active transport using energy, absorbing them again into the blood capillaries. Now water is absorbed by osmosis, right? Okay, not diffusion, by osmosis into the blood capillaries. Now fatty acids and glycerol is the interesting one. Okay, fatty acids and glycerol, they are absorbed by diffusion into the epithelium. Now, before they enter the lacteals, they recombine to form fat globules. Okay, so somehow the fatty acids and glycerol, they diffuse inside here. They recombine to form little globules of fat and they enter the lacteals. Alright, key point. The key point is glucose and amino acids absorb into the blood capillaries. Fatty acids and glycerol, the fats, are absorbed into lacteals. Alright, so you need to know the difference between what the blood capillaries absorb and what the lacteals absorb. Now into the last part of this topic, we're going to look at how is the small intestine adapted for absorption. Now you can read your textbook first on page 101 and fill in these blanks. Alright, so pause here and go and read about how the small intestine is adapted for absorption. Fill in these blanks. Pause. I hope you've read your textbook, and what you might have saw was that one way that the small intestine is adapted for absorption is that its surface area is increased. It has an increased surface area for absorption. Now the surface area of the small intestine is increased in three ways, and we've seen this already. Firstly, the inner wall of the intestine has many folds. You see that here, the many folds. Now, each fold is lined by many finger-like projections called villi, right? We've already seen that, so these are many villi. Now, there's one more way that surface area is increased, and that is that the epithelial cells of the villi have many microvilli. So you can see this little long and narrow protrusions here. These are microvilli, right? They give our epithelial cells a very cool hairdo. But these are microvilli. Now, these three adaptations all help to increase the surface area, increase surface area further, and increase the surface area further. Now, in your test paper, please write that it increases the surface area to volume ratio of the small intestine. And that's why it can increase the rate of absorption. Right, so that's how the small intestine is adapted for absorption. Increased surface area. Now, the second way in which the small intestine is adapted for absorption is that the epithelium, this layer of cells on the outside of the villus, is only one cell thick. Now, how does this help increase the rate of absorption? In order to answer this question, imagine if the villus was very, very thick, right? The epithelium of the villus is very, very thick. So this is the epithelium. Imagine if it's very, 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 very thick. Would nutrients be absorbed faster through a one-cell thick layer or through a many-cell thick layer? Which one will be faster? Well, clearly, if the epithelium is one cell thick, absorption can happen a lot faster. So absorption of digested substances takes a shorter time across a smaller distance. And one cell thick distance takes a very short time for the digested substances to be absorbed across that one cell thick layer. Alright, so crucial point is that the villus epithelium is only one cell thick. Alright, the third adaptation is that the small intestine is very long, and this increases the time that is for nutrients to be absorbed because they flow through the whole length of it. Now, how long is the small intestine? If you look it up, it's about 6 meters long. So nutrients will flow through 6 meters, allowing a very long time for absorption. Alright, the fourth way and final way that the small intestine is adapted for absorption has to do with this idea that the concentration gradient for absorption is maintained. Alright, so here's our villus, and imagine if we absorb a lot of nutrients into our villus. Now imagine if I just left it this way, I didn't transport the nutrients out. Over time, all the nutrients will accumulate inside the villus, and there will be no more diffusion, right? There will be no more concentration gradient for absorption. So that is why it's important that the moment that digested substances are absorbed inside the villus, that we carry them away from the intestine. So absorb and then carry them away immediately so that we can maintain this concentration gradient. We can maintain this flow of nutrients into the villus. And we do this by having a rich supply of blood and lymphatic capillaries to the small intestine. So the small intestine has a very rich supply of blood, rich supply of lymphatic capillaries, so that we can quickly carry away nutrients and maintain the concentration gradient for absorption. Alright, so to sum up, right, if you read your textbook, on that page, these are the 4 points about how the small intestine is adapted for absorption. Alright, so great, have a read through that, and you can ask questions in class.